Now, I'm going to talk about some types here of schizophrenia, and I will note that these types are no longer supported in the DSM-5. The DSM-5 is the latest edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. These types have been present all the way up till now, or most of these types have been present up until now. So historically speaking, they're important. I think they also provide good examples of the kinds of manifestations you might see with schizophrenia, because all of these are possibilities. Paranoid type is dominated by delusions of persecution, delusions of grandeur, or ideas of reference. Ideas of reference mean that unrelated events to oneself are seen as being highly relevant to oneself. Now, grandeur sounds like it's great, like, oh man, I'm the best, I'm the awesomest. Now, I've met Jesus Christ at Broughton State Hospital. I have met King George at Broughton State Hospital. That's grandeur the way most people think about it. Now, clearly, you're not the second coming of Jesus Christ in Broughton State Hospital, all right? Nor are you King George from any era of English history, right? You're a guy who happens to be in a mental hospital because you have schizophrenia, and your delusion is that you're this incredibly important figure. That's grandeur. But there's other kinds of grandeur, which is the idea that you specifically are singled out for some kind of special or ominous treatment by the world. So persecution, that's common too, but not always in the way that people think about it and ideas of reference. I'll give you a couple examples of people that I worked with that I like. That's what I like to emphasize. These are people with a disorder, right? Not monsters, not other than human. These are human beings that, if you get the chance to know them, are oftentimes very wonderful people who are afflicted by very devastating diseases. So one guy fits the what used to be called paranoid type, and I won't say his name, it doesn't really matter, you wouldn't know who he was, but you gotta be careful with that. You wanna be very careful with confidentiality and privacy with people, right? But anyway, I'll just call him Joe, and I'll say his real given name is Frank. So Joe believed that he wasn't Frank, right? He is Frank by his documents of birth, by his social security card, by his family. Everybody that knows him would have called him Frank, and that's who he was to them. But to him, he never was that guy. I'm Joe. My real name is Joe. Communists captured my real family, and they're holding them prisoner in Kannapolis because that family lost their child named Frank. And they have connections with the Communist Party who captured my family, and they say I have to be a substitute for Frank, so they want me to act like I'm their kid. Now, this guy's 50-something years old. I have to act like I'm Frank, but I'm not Frank, I'm Joe. And I don't know how to get out of this. So there you have that persecution, right? He's being made to act like somebody he's not, or bad things will happen to people he loves. It's also him being singled out, right? Out of all the people in the world that might be called to play this other person, this other family's son, it's him, right? So that's kind of that grandeur, right? He didn't have the ideas of reference so much, but he had this delusion, this belief structure that was clearly counter to reality. We could prove that his family wasn't being held by communists because there they were. But he just incorporated that into the delusion. Those aren't my real family. Those are communist agents, stuff like that. And he could be funny, but he wasn't trying to be funny, but he had a fairly good sense of humor, and he was an interesting guy. He also believed that aliens came down at night and would take him up into their ship and operate on him, and that he would be fine the next day, and he would tell you stuff. So regarding Frank, I'm like, well, I didn't challenge this. I was just a mental health tech. My job's to hang out with the guy and make sure he makes it to his next appointment in the facility, et cetera. And I'm just hanging out talking to him. He's a nice guy. He's a funny guy, but he's not trying to be funny, but he laughs when you laugh in kind of an inappropriate way. But I said, well, so what happened to the real Frank? If you're not Frank and you're Joe, and he's got all the other patients calling him Joe, it's not his real name, but he believes it is, and he's got all of them believing he's really this other person. I'm like, well, so whatever happened to the other Frank that you got to replace? He's like, oh, he got bit by a snake. I was like, he got bit by a snake? He's like, yeah. I said, what kind of snake did he get bit by? He's like, one of them kinds you can't see too good. I said, oh, right, because if you'd have seen it, you'd have never got bitten. He's like, yeah. So one of those kind of snakes you can't see too good. And then he was talking to me one day, standing in front of me, and he said, they got my spine last night, talking about the aliens coming down and operating on him. And I said, really? He's like, yeah. I'm like, you know that if they got your spine, you couldn't actually be standing there talking to me because you need a spine to stand up. He goes, oh, they put it back. And I went, he goes, I'm like, I got you. It was odd, but he believed all of these things in the face of evidence to the contrary. I also worked with another guy who believed that he fought the mafia. He lived in a nursing home. He stayed in the nursing home. The nursing home staff could account for all of his comings and goings, which were none, because he stayed there all the time. But he believed he was out fighting organized crime and that the television gave him instructions. So when he's in the day room and everybody else is watching the news, he's hearing the news talk to him about what he's supposed to be doing to fight organized crime. He's getting coded instructions, ideas of reference. Something that's not related to him is being referred directly to him. So it's a very unusual thing, and it makes people uncomfortable. That guy's biggest complaint was not that he had hallucinations and delusions, because they weren't, to him, delusions. They were realities. His biggest complaint was that he was lonely. Nobody would be his friend because it was such an unusual thing to talk to him about. And I suggested to him, and it pissed him off. I wasn't a therapist at the time. I just said, you know, practically speaking, you seem like a pretty nice guy. You would agree that you're not fighting the mafia right here while we're talking to each other. He's like, no, of course not. Of course not. I'm like, well, I'm not saying you don't. I don't know. Maybe there's another plane of reality you exist on. I'm not saying that you don't. I'm not going to argue with you because there's no way to argue with this person. If I argue with him, then what am I? I'm an agent of the mafia trying to convince him that he doesn't fight the mafia. So he'll just pull me into his delusion. So I just roll with it. I said, but you'll agree you're not fighting the mafia when you're talking to me. And when you're in the day room talking to other people, you're not fighting it then. He's like, no. I'm like, why don't you just not tell people? Why don't you just not tell people that you do that? He's like, but I do. I said, I'm not saying you don't. I'm saying, why don't you just not tell people that you do until after you get to know them? Because you seem like a pretty nice guy to me. And that if they got to know you, well, then they might be your friend. And he got a little agitated, but a couple months later, he's like, it works. I've got friends. And I'm like, that's cool, man. How you doing? He's like, I just don't tell them. I'm like, that's awesome. And after a while, another name for him, Bob, we'll call him Bob. Bob's just this sweet little old man who thinks he fights the mafia, and in his world, that's truth, and there's no arguing with him. But once you get to know Bob, and then he tells you, it's not so weird. It's like, oh, Bob's cool. He's just a little weird, a little different, but he's cool. So he made friends before he started revealing his delusions and hallucinations, which were not anything critical. It's not going to hurt anybody if he believes that. And that's the thing, is people get put off by that. I'll give you one more example on this tip right here. A guy in Blacksburg who goes around talking like this. He talks really, really, really loud. He's a really, really tall guy. And he gets really intense. And he's an older fella. And he comes up to you in the post office and he says, did you see the game? Did you see the game? Did you see the game? And you say nothing. Most people are like this. You never seen people get so tight ass as they turn around and they're like this. They got their stuff, they're ready in line, and the post office staff are ignoring him like he's not even in here. Now, he's not trespassing, he's on public property. He's not assaulting anybody. He's just trying to have conversations that nobody else wants to have in a very abrasive manner. Myself not being disaffected by that kind of stuff, I just go, what game? He's like, the game. And he's talking about a game that occurred in like the 1950s. As if it occurred yesterday. And I have a conversation like, oh, it was very good. And he's talking about his game in Texas, and we go on and we have a conversation. No big deal to me. Doesn't freak me out, doesn't scare me, doesn't bother me. And then my turn comes, I'm like, I gotta go get it. He's like, oh, cool, yeah. So I go up and I transact my business at the counter, and I go and I'm like, hey man, it's nice talking to you. I'm gonna take off and leave now. He's like, you have a great day. No big deal. But believe me, if he shows up in the wrong place talking like that, somebody's going to call the cops because they're uncomfortable with that kind of behavior because it is totally socially inappropriate, right? There's no screen for that. There's no inhibition of that. And that's what gets him and others like him in trouble most often. You will see stories of people in the media who do dramatically horrible things because they're under delusions and hallucinations, right? That's highly dramatized because it's pretty damn dramatic, but it's not common. It's unusual. It could happen, yes. People who kill their children because they think the devil's going to take them and they're trying to send their child to heaven, clearly hallucinations and delusions are involved. Doesn't excuse the behavior. You still have to hold them accountable for the behavior, but that's very different than just somebody saying, you know what, I'm sick of being a parent, I'm going to kill these little kids. That's not what's occurring in those cases, and that kind of thing is relatively rare. When you do see it, it's dramatic. It gets a lot of play in the media. I'm not saying it shouldn't. I'm just saying y'all know the availability heuristic right now. Don't assume that that is some kind of common thing for people who are suffering from schizophrenia. Catatonic type, and again, remember, these categories aren't here anymore, but this one's dominated by motor disturbances, ranging from muscular rigidity to relatively random activity, tick-like movements. There's this thing called waxy flexibility. I've only seen it on videotape. I've never seen it in person, but it's pretty unusual to see it. So waxy flexibility is the idea that a person might just stop wherever they are in whatever position they're in when they stop and just stay there for hours. And hours, and you could come up to them and maybe raise their arm up like that, and it'll just stay there. So you're like, ain't you just trying to get attention to something? Try to do that. I challenge you to try to hold your arm up for 2 or 3 hours. About 5 minutes into it, you'll be like, oh man, they ain't faking. That's uncomfortable. It's hard to do that. There is a motor disturbance. This does seem to be very much related to brain issues. Neurological condition does seem to be implicated here. It can be exacerbated by social factors and environmental factors and stressors and things like that. But that's just not something you're faking. It's very unusual and it's pretty rare. And that's why they got rid of the categories, is they say, well, you know, there doesn't seem to be any research support to keep these distinctions going because there's so few people in these other types. There's a lot in the paranoid type. Disorganized type is dominated by severe deterioration of adaptive behavior. Adaptive behavior is what you and I engage in on a daily basis. So you get up in the morning, you turn off the alarm, you go brush your teeth, you get dressed, you have a breakfast or something, you go to your job or you go to school, you interact with people, and you are adapting all day long, and you are able to function as a result. So here is a lack of functioning because the person's thought processes become so skewed. There's this thing called word salad, which is just strange to listen to. It's as if they're talking to you in sentences and paragraphs with meaning and content. They're gesticulating like it's something really important, but it doesn't make any sense because it's a random mix of words, and I have to read to be able to do it. So a dominated type, waxy flexibility, dominated, severe. You know what I'm saying? Severe sounds, words, things, ideas, and it's just like all these random words. It sounds like they're trying to say something very emphatically, but none of the words are linking up to create logical cohesion. And so you look at that, it's a fairly rare type. I've seen examples of that. Nowadays, you don't need to know this for your test, but be aware that nowadays, there's just not a good research basis to support having these individually distinguished types of schizophrenia. Most of what you saw was paranoid type ideation. These other symptoms are possible manifestations, but another thing I think it's important to show with this is this. These have been around for many, many, many decades, and here they are revising the way they do it based on research. So you don't just do stuff to do it. If there's no research support for it, eventually they change the way they do it. And in that case, I say, you can see that we're moving forward as a science slowly because these are complicated issues, but we are moving forward and we're using science as our guide. Given how close we are to the end of this session, let's just wrap it up right now and take an extra minute off this morning. Y'all have a good day and we'll see you on the Wednesday.